And Lord, we can depend and stand upon it. And so here we are, coming to your word, to stand upon your word and to let it teach us and to let it grow us and to help us to magnify you. So Lord, as we jump into this, again, our prayer is that you would be glorified in it. And we thank you for it, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this morning, I want to start to turn our thinking upon the passage today in Matthew, which is touching on the subject of how to be considered great in God's kingdom. Now, you might say, Pastor Garrett, we already touched on this back in Matthew chapter 18 when Jesus pulled, if you guys remember, he pulled that child into the circle of the disciples and said, if you want to be great in the kingdom, then you need to be like this child. Specifically, you need to be humble like this child. So why are we looking at this again? Well, for starters, Jesus is bringing it up again. And so we preach through the scriptures, and as we do, we're going to preach what Jesus preaches. If Jesus thinks it's worth repeating, I guess it's worth repeating for us as well. But why is Jesus bringing this up again is the question here in chapter 20 of Matthew. Well, the simple answer is because the disciples aren't getting it. They don't seem to get the message that Jesus is teaching here. And so in Matthew 18, Jesus said to his disciples, "Come humble yourself like a child to be great in the kingdom of God." Shuffle a chapter ahead, and we see the disciples doing what? Pushing the children away as they're coming to Jesus. And Jesus had to rebuke them and say, no, don't stop them from coming to me, for such as belongs to them, the kingdom of God. So they didn't understand what it meant to be great even just a few moments after Christ teaching on it. Shuffle again, chapter 20, our passage today. They're still clawing for this greatness in the kingdom for all the wrong reasons and all the wrong ways, as we shall see in a moment. And then jump ahead to the Last Supper, again, in Luke 22, 24, that the disciples are there, and even at that late hour, as Christ is about to be crucified, Christ was getting ready to go to the cross, the disciples were still disputing among each other who was going to be the greatest in the kingdom, what great role they would have there. And so it was at that moment, I think, that Jesus got down on his knees and he washes the feet of the disciples. So, you see, all along the way, Jesus had to constantly be at war with pride, with self-importance, with self-glorifying nature of the disciples. This is why Jesus repeated this teaching on what it means to be great so many times. This is why we need to have it repeated to us again today. Pride, self-importance, self-glorification. It's a disease of our heart. It comes back again and again and again. And so here's the reality. We were made for a specific purpose, and that purpose is to glorify God with our lives. That's why we were created. I was saying to my wife this morning, you know, when we read that the stars proclaim the glory of God, and we look at the oceans, and we look at the trees, and we look at everything that's been created, what was the purpose of it? It's to declare the glory of God. So why not us? We're supposed to be that too. We're part of the creation of God. We're made to declare his glory. But there's a problem. When Adam fell, and we took on our sin nature, we took that glory that was meant for God and we turned it and we put it upon ourselves. We moved it from Godward to ourselves, glorifying ourselves. And so the reality is we live in a time of incredible pride. And this is perhaps the most self-glorifying, egotistical generation we have seen in a long time. We are pushing ourselves and promoting ourselves at every chance we get. We see pride as a virtue these days. I remember growing up playing hockey, and man, we were trying to be the coolest. Everybody was trying to be the coolest on the team, and we would boast about how cool we thought we were. And it just seemed to be this pride that we thought was a virtue. In the church, we see God as primarily for us and our benefit, and we are the center of importance. We are enough. We are special. We use God to pat our egos and our self-esteem. And John Piper wrote, sometimes on the current self-love cult, he says, commenting on that, today the first and greatest command is, thou shalt love thyself. Social media, oh boy, has that created an avenue for us to promote ourselves. There's a new app for your phone that you can get. It's called TikTok. Who knows about TikTok? Yeah, TikTok. It's a very popular app these days. And in the app, you can create videos that give you 1 minute to show off who you are. And so you got 1 minute to show off, dancing, singing, giving your opinions, you name it. And people are selling themselves out. Girls are wearing as little clothing as they can. Men are showing off their muscles. Why? Because they're desperate for likes. If I can just get more likes and more shares and more views, then that means I'm important. They're seeking glory. They're trying to seek their self-glory, and they eat it up. And then you go down in the comment section, and you read the comment section of those social media times, and you can see people arguing about how important they are by the number of likes they have. Now, if this is not evidence, if this is not evidence for us of living in a generation of self-promoting, self-glorifying, pride-filled people, I don't know what is. We're so caught up in our own self-importance and promoting self rather than God, which is supposed to be our mission. So, Christ, by repeating himself again and again on this subject, is going to war against our sinful pride, and he's discipling us. He is saying, if you want to be great in the kingdom, if you want to be great, a great person in the kingdom of God, great in God's eyes, if that's what you want to do, then let me show you what greatness really looks like to God. And it's this, Proverbs 18:12. Before destruction, a man's heart is haughty, but humility comes before honor. Humility comes before honor. Jesus says greatness in God's eyes looks like this, humility. If you want to be honored by God, then you need to be humble. Humility that causes us to die to self, to deny ourselves, to give up our pursuit of treasures on earth for treasures in heaven, to take up our crosses, to follow Jesus, and it means that we suffer for his sake. This is the hardest lesson for any Christian to learn. And many people want nothing to do with cross-bearing these days. Especially in North America, we've had it so good. We don't want anything to do with cross-bearing. And so we have to repeat this for ourselves to hear what it means to be great and what it means to have our focus in the right place. Jesus said his kingdom is not like the kingdom of man. It's not of this world. So what the world says is greatness is not the same as what God says is greatness. And the kingdom of God operates on different terms. And so today I just want us to look at this passage and see that. See what God says greatness looks like for us. How we ought to operate in that. So with that, if you could turn in your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 20, verses 20 through 28. And we're going to read Christ's teaching on this subject, what it means to be great. Matthew 20, verses 20 to 28. All right, it says this. Then the mother of the sons of Zebedee came up to him with her sons, and kneeling before him, she asked him for something. And he said to her, "What do you want?" And she said to him, "Say that these two sons of mine are to sit, one at your right hand, one at your left, in your kingdom." And Jesus answered, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I am to drink?" And they said to him, "We are able." And he said to them, "You will drink my cup. But to sit at my right hand and at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father." And when the 10 heard it, they were indignant at the two brothers. But Jesus called them to him and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. It shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Whoever would be first among you must be your slave, even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." So our passage begins in verse 20 to 21 with the mother of the sons of Zebedee coming to Jesus. And the sons of Zebedee are the disciples James and John. This is not James, the brother of Jesus. This is James and John, the brothers. And in other parts of Scripture, they're referred to as the sons of thunder. And they get that name because they are full of spunk. They're bold. They're zealous. But that's what they got. It's a Jewish term for the time. Now, in terms of the mother, We know, as we read the Gospels, that she is one of the women at the foot of the cross. So when Jesus is on the cross being crucified, her name is mentioned in the Gospels during the crucifixion. She's one of three women. Her name is Salome. So this mother, Salome, mother of James and John, she comes to Jesus and she makes this request of him. And it's a very inappropriate request. She just walks up and says to Jesus, "Say that these two of mine are to sit, one at your right hand, one at your left in your kingdom." This is a very good Jewish mother. She wants her boys to go on and do good in the future. And she's coming up with that, wanting to solidify it. Now, before we let James and John off the hook, if you read the other Gospels, it says that they came and said it to Jesus. So what we're actually seeing here is all three of them are coming together to say it. Three of them are in this together. It's not just the mom. We can't just point the finger at mom here. It's all three who have come. And their request is both misguided and downright sinful. They're seeking self-glory here. The Bible says that God resists the proud and that pride is sinful. And I can think of nothing more prideful than to think that you or I deserve to sit on the throne to the right or to the left of the Creator of heaven and earth. Can you just put them there? Make them great. Talk about overestimating our importance. Now, this moment was, according to Mark MacArthur, much like a political move. They knew Jesus. They had an in with Jesus. Her sons were disciples of Jesus. This is our chance to move in and request something of the king. It's kind of a political move. So they move in. It was manipulation, in a sense. Not only does this mother and her sons come and kneel before Jesus like a request from a king, which is fine, he is a king, but often it's done to flatter before the request is made. But also, we read in Mark 10 that they wanted Jesus to agree with what they were going to say to him before they said it. Mark 10 says, they say, "Jesus, we want you to do whatever we ask of you." So before they tell him, they just say, "Hey, can you just do whatever we say next? That would be great." But Jesus doesn't fall for it, right? Jesus says, "Hey, what do you want?" So, talk about bold. Not only is this childish to sit here and say, "Agree to whatever I tell you next, or I'm not telling you," but it is also manipulative. Just consider for a moment the lengths they're going in order to glorify themselves, in order to ensure greatness in their own eyes, in order to ensure that they get the chief seats in the kingdom. I think if their heart's in the right place, it'd be like, "Jesus gets the chief seat. I am not worthy to sit beside this man." So like them, I think we are today easily made drunk by the desire of self-glory. We're easily intoxicated by our self-worth and self-importance. And it betrays the Christian life. It betrays the Christian life. It betrays our created purpose. We're to make much of Christ. That's our calling. That's what we were created for, to make much of Christ. And then in that, we become what we were meant to be, and we are valuable. So Jesus responds to this request by saying, basically, "You don't know what you're asking. You don't know what you're asking. You speak of greatness, but you fail to understand how one becomes great. You don't know what you are asking." And then Jesus says the telltale comment. He says, "Are you able to drink the cup that I am to drink? Are you able to drink the cup that I am to drink?" Who would we say is the greatest person that ever lived? Well, I think it should be, obviously, as Christians, we would say Jesus is the greatest person that ever lived. Now, if Jesus is the greatest person who ever lived, then I guess he should be our example of what it means to be great and how one becomes great. Well, then, let's look at the life of Jesus for a second. What did Jesus' life look like? Did he sit in a castle, covered in nice robes, just kind of living in the lap of luxury, telling everyone what to do? Is that what Jesus did? No, it looked like this. It looked like suffering, and it looked like humiliation. That's how Jesus lived, in a life of suffering and humiliation. Jesus came to suffer and die and to give his life as a ransom for many. He had no place to lay his head. He served. He was mocked. He was persecuted. He was accused, though he was without sin. When he was on the cross, he was stripped of his clothes. And when he got on that cross, he bore our shame, and he took the wrath of God that was meant for us upon himself. That's what made him great. Not his clothing or his castles or his power. He didn't have any of that. He got up on that cross and was humbled to the point of death. Philippians chapter 2, 5 to 11 illustrates this perfectly for us. It sums up well the kind of life Jesus lived. It said, Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. But he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant. Being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So even though Jesus is God, it says here he did not, while on earth, try to maintain and hold on to the glory of God. He didn't try to hold on to, look at me, I'm God. He allowed himself to be considered less in the eyes of men. This is what it means that he emptied himself. Empty himself doesn't mean that he gave up his divinity. But it does mean this, that he gave up the incredible recognized glory that was deserved him. He emptied himself of his deserved place on the throne of God. He did not seek to be seen and held on the same plane as God. While he was on earth, he didn't go around boasting about it. He gave us little hints here and there, taught us little things that made us see, he is God. But he didn't go around shining all the time. We have these little moments where his divinity comes forth. He didn't try to put himself on the same level of God in that sense of glory in himself, which is actually what James and John are trying to do, by the way. They're trying to put themselves beside Christ on the throne. Look, I am on the same level there as God. To sit at the right and the left of Jesus. But Jesus does the exact opposite of what these guys are asking. He emptied himself of his deserved glory, and he took the form not as a king or as a god, but he took the form of what? A servant. And he humbled himself. In fact, humiliated himself is a proper way of saying it. He became obedient to the Father to the point of death, even death on a cross. Jesus does not deserve death. He humbled himself to the point of death. He does not deserve the curse of the cross, but he went to the cross anyways. My friends, that is the cup that Jesus drank. That is the greatness that is his. That is what makes Jesus great. That is the nobility of God on display. And because of this act of self-sacrifice and servanthood and humility, the passage goes on to say, therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. The Father shows how great Jesus is after he humiliates himself and brings himself low. God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. So Jesus showed us how great he is by coming low and suffering. And so, sons of Zebedee, he says, can you drink the cup that Jesus drank? Can you suffer like Jesus is going to suffer? And even to us here, dear listeners here at Kentwood, can you drink the cup that Jesus drank? Are you ready to die for Jesus if need be? John and James, they so arrogantly reply, we are able. Of course, we can do that. We're able. They have no idea what they're saying. They did not have the ability, no. They do not get to be great by boasting in their self-confidence, and neither do we. We are indeed given an easy gospel these days of God's love and grace, and so often we omit the part of dying to self, suffering for Christ, carrying our cross, all of which Jesus says must happen if we are to follow him. We do it not in our own strength, though. We do it in the strength of God. So, Jesus drank the full cup on the cross of sin's poison and the wrath of the Father. And we only get a sip. We only get a sip to suffer like Jesus. So what does greatness look like? Well, just look to Christ's life. It's not easy. It was not full of leisure and riches. It was full of sacrifice, suffering, humiliation, service for the sake of others. That is what the kingdom of heaven calls great. That is how you and I find greatness in the kingdom of God as well. As long as we are glorifying self and worshiping self and being full of self-importance, we will never become great like Jesus. And just to reinforce this point, it's no coincidence that Matthew, right before we jump into the passage we're in today, verses 17 to 19, right before this passage, Matthew records Christ telling the disciples for a third time that he was going to have to die. It says, he took the 12 disciples aside, and on the way he said to them, "See, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death, and deliver him over to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified, and he will be raised on the third day." The point that Jesus is trying to show them, that as they argue about who will be great in the kingdom, that their king will have to suffer and die. As you guys argue about who's going to be great, your king is going to suffer and die and be mocked and be put on a cross. Get the hint, guys. You will be following your king into suffering and death. Not easy living, blessings and comfort. Do not follow Jesus unless you understand that this is the cup that we may be made to drink. I always think, you know, we talk about it, the news, and we're turning on the news. Who knows what the days ahead are going to bring? We've lived here in North America with freedom and the grace of God to be able to worship freely and be who we are. But who knows what the days ahead are going to bring? Our culture is shifting fast, really fast. It's mob rule right now. Are you ready? Are we ready for a shift that could possibly take place? I don't say this to make us afraid. I say this to say, are we ready to drink the cup? Are we ready to take a sip if need be for Christ? Are you ready to forsake whatever you may have by humbling yourself before God and suffering for the sake of Him and the kingdom? Are you ready? Do not find yourself, when hardship comes, when persecution comes, taking comfort in our sin or in compromise. Our culture is changing so fast. And we have a problem. The problem is, as we tear down statues and as we point the finger at everybody else, we're not looking at our own sins, saying the heart of sin that caused those guys to be slave owners is the same heart I have inside of me. And if not for the grace of God, I would have been a slave owner. We're not taking ownership of our sin in this world. Verse 23, Jesus says to James and John, after they declare that they can indeed drink the cup, in verse 23, he said to them, "You will drink my cup. But to sit at my right hand and at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father." You will drink the cup, Jesus says to James and John. James was the first disciple to be martyred. He was beheaded by King Herod in 44 AD during a general persecution of the church. John was one of the only disciples that was not martyred, but not for lack of trying. The early father Tertullian says that he was boiled in oil, but he survived before he was exiled to the island of Patmos, where he received his revelation for the book of Revelation. These men did indeed take a sip from the cup of Christ's suffering. The greatness they had anticipated didn't work out while you're being boiled in oil. It's not my choice anyways, Jesus says, who sits on the right or left. And this is the Father's decision. The Father will see our hearts and our actions. He will determine who is great. The Father will glorify who He chooses to glorify in His wisdom and His understanding. And Jesus is in the mode here of being obedient and submitting to the Father. He's busy being great. He's busy doing what we should be doing. And so verse 24, moving on, verse 24 we read, "And when the 10 heard it," these are the other disciples, "they were indignant at the two brothers." Now at first you might think that they saw the foolishness and the sinfulness of the brothers' request and they were angry for them being so wicked. I can't believe they would say that. What's wrong with those guys? But that's actually not what's happening here at all. They are mad not because they're spiritually more mature and holy. They're mad because they were thinking the same thing and they're upset that the brothers were jumping to it first. That's why they're mad. They're jealous. I can't believe that they did that before I did. That's actually what's happening. We know this because all along the gospel, they have been arguing about who would be the greatest, and later on still having such discussions, like at the Last Supper, as I've already said. They're all wickedly thinking the same thing. They're all self-glorifying, prideful guys. This is our king. He's come. He's going to conquer. We're going to get our place in the special seats. So they're all doing it. They're all pointing at them. Now I want to suggest to us that before we point the fingers at these brothers, before we shake our heads and wag our fingers at what these guys were doing, that we check our own lives and thinking and just see how often we choose self-importance over gospel and self-glory and comfort over truth. How often we do that? Aha! Now guess what? We're part of the story. We are not necessarily on Jesus' side here. We are the brothers. We may not be asking for thrones in heaven. We might think, well, I've never asked for that. But indeed, right now in our lives, we often choose what makes us happy over what makes us holy. So no wag, no shake of the head, no saying how foolish of them for us. The same sin dwells in us. It just shows up in different ways. So ending with this last verse now, verses 25 through 28. Jesus, having seen them grumbling amongst each other for the greatness and power, we read in verse 25 through 28, but Jesus called them to him and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. It shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Whoever would be first among you must be your slave. Even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, to give his life as a ransom for many. So Jesus says, look, guys, see how the Gentile rulers act towards its own people. See how Caesar and the Roman authorities use their power to control and dominate others. See how the kingdoms of the world see greatness with riches, the power of the sword, forceful demands of the one who's holding the bigger stick. And he says, it shall not be so among you. This is not what it looks like in the kingdom of God. Church, Kenwood, it shall not be so among you. This is not how the kingdom of God operates. This is not how the kingdom of heaven works. You'll not fight each other for power or for greatness. Rather, Jesus points to the two lowest titles in that culture to express what it looks like to be great in the kingdom. Whoever is to be great must become a servant and a slave. That is what is great in God's eyes, a servant and a slave. Servants act for the benefit of others. Imagine if all of us were in a place where we're lifting our brothers and sisters up towards Christ, not trying to be better than them, but lifting them up, helping them up towards Christ, encouraging them on. Servants lead by giving people a hand. Servants do not look to be served, but to get to work helping others. Servants sacrifice their time and their energy, and they humble themselves enough to exalt others above themselves. They're not looking to be Lord and Master or be exalted. Their greatest desire is to be found faithful. I want to be found faithful. Likewise, a slave gives up all rights to self, lives only to serve their master. The Bible says in Romans that we who are in Christ have gone from being a slave to sin to a slave to righteousness, a slave to Christ. And so we look to please our master, and we're bound in service to him. We look to do what is right and pleasing to God. And this is the reality of a slave. My freedom is not my greatest desire. I'm bound in this case joyfully to serve my king and to serve my brethren. And Jesus is our example. The ultimate picture of slave and servant is not unjustly asked for us by us, to us by our Lord. Because he himself went for those things. He himself became those things. Here's the difference between a slave and a slave servant versus someone who's trying to take control. He's sitting in the garden and saying, Lord, if it be your will, pass this cup from me. But you know what? Your will be done. Even though he may have wanted to not go to that cross, he didn't want to go suffer, he chose to anyways, because he's a servant to God the Father. He's a slave to God the Father. He wants to be there. And he's also that to us. He gave his life. That's what it says here. Even as the Son of Man came, not to be served, but to serve, to give his life as a ransom for many. If God can step off his throne to serve, surely we can step off ours. I guarantee you that the step was much larger for Christ than it will be for us. There is greatness on display here. God humbled himself, became a servant, rather than be served, and he gave his very life for others. Greater is no love than this, that a man lay down his life for a friend. And Jesus laid down his life to ransom, meaning pay for and redeem us from our sin and the wrath of God. It was payment to purchase for himself a church. The many are those whom he gave his life to redeem. And Titus 2:14 talks about that. He gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession. You are a believer in Christ because Jesus became a servant and a slave and ransomed you by going to the cross so that you would be his own possession. What a rescue. What a savior. He's our example of greatness. May we become slaves and servants for God and for each other. As one great pastor said it, and this is a great quote, he said it well. He said, "You cannot be Christ's servant if you're not willing to follow him, cross and all. What do you crave? A crown? Then it must be a crown of thorns if you are to be like him. Do you want to be lifted up? So you shall, but it will be upon a cross." I think the application for us today is straightforward. Where do we need to be killing our thoughts of self-importance and begin to become a humble servant and slave for God? When are we going to give up pursuing our own greatness in exchange for the greatness of God? So I want to end with this illustration. Have you ever heard of Brother Lawrence? He was a monk who lived in the 17th century. He was born in France and served as a French soldier. And he was one day converted by looking at a tree in winter, stripped of its leaves, and reflecting on the fact that within a short time, its leaves would be renewed through the love and power of God. He became a monk in 1666, and at the Carmelite monastery where he was assigned, Lawrence was put in the kitchen where he was put in charge of the utensils. He was in charge of the dishes. That was his life. At first, he hated the work, but he set himself to walk in God's presence so that he could worship God and serve others in his humble circumstances. In time, he came to worship God more in the kitchen than in the cathedral, and he would pray, this is his prayer, "Lord of all pots and pans and things, make me a saint by getting meals and washing up the dishes." His meditations on Christian life became the book called The Practice of the Presence of God, which is now a Christian classic. Brother Lawrence chose humility and servanthood and self-sacrifice, and by it he achieved greatness. Whatever we're doing, it's important that we put ourselves in a place where we're willing to say, "All for Jesus. I'm going to do what he's asked me to do. I'm going to give up some of these things that maybe I desire or I want. I'm going to work when I don't feel like it. I'm going to push when I don't have the energy necessarily. I'm just going to continue to serve him as a servant and serve each other." So we're made great, not by always getting what we want. We're made great in the kingdom of God's eyes by being humble, picking up our cross, following after him, denying ourselves. That's the picture Jesus gave us. That's the picture we need to live by. Let's pray as the worship team comes forward. Heavenly Father, thank you for this passage, Lord. And I admit that even as I am going through this passage, I found myself throughout the week finding places where I was being self-glorifying, where I was thinking too much about whether this world thought I was great. And you corrected me every time by your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray that you do that in all of us. that you would continue to just kill this side of us where we want to be happy rather than holy, where we want to be getting all the things we want rather than eagerly desiring to serve in the kingdom of God. It's a heart change we need, Lord, and we ask you to change our hearts. I ask you, Holy Spirit, to point out in our lives where we are self-glorifying and just being ambitious for our own sakes. Help us not to be in a place where we expect you to make us great, but that we look at you and say, you are the great one, O Holy Lord. May we walk in your example, your death for the sins of the world. We thank you, Lord, for these things. We ask you bless our thinking in the coming moments, in the coming day, as we meditate on your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.